In the atmosphere of the moment, all the pressure was to get the aid into Ethiopia. Few realized what might happen to it when it got there. The world was moved by the instinct to help.
It wasn't too difficult for us in the UN to accept this idea that a hungry child has no politics. We were there just to deal with the relief operation and to get the food to the people who were starving.
Yet while it's true that hungry children know no politics, it's the politics that so often make them hungry. It was accepted from the outset that the only way to get aid to the starving was to work with the Mengistu regime. But at that time, Mengistu did not control Ethiopia. He was prosecuting two wars in the north, in Tigray and in Eritrea, and one in the south. And the critics maintain he was using food as a weapon of war.
The Ethiopian government said quite openly, food is a major component in our strategy against the rebels. And throughout the 1980s, the Ethiopian government was deliberately inflicting famine on particularly Tigray and the neighboring regions.
Duval saw how when he witnessed the war in northern Ethiopia later in the 80s.
The Ethiopian government was creating famine out of nothing. By military checkpoints on the roads, which prevented movement of people and movement of food, and by systematically bombing the markets in rebel-held areas.
The Ethiopian government's campaign of bombing, specifically against the civilian population, not against military targets, but against the civilian population in rebel areas, was something that I stumbled onto time and time again. It was one of the things that made it very difficult to believe any of the assurances the Ethiopian government was making to the international community that it was doing everything possible to reach the victims of this famine when at the same time it was bombing them at every opportunity, out of sight, out of mind of the international community.
The television images of the famine were shocking, but a huge number of the victims, possibly most of them, were ignored by both the cameras and the official aid operation. These accessible victims were filmed in areas under Ethiopian government control. But much of the population in the regions hit hardest by the famine was in the rebel-held countryside. With only a small proportion of the international aid reaching them, they had to save themselves. So the rebel movements, supported by a handful of aid agencies, brought in relief supplies cross-border from neighboring Sudan. Meanwhile, the official aid operation was working with the Ethiopian authorities, who denied that the rebels controlled any territory and maintained they could reach every famine victim.
The international community itself is made of course, governments, and whoever controls the capital city and few airports and the government, they dealt with governments, but that government had no political, moral legitimacy really in the country, had no right to decide to carry out those programs.
In the 80s, Taha Abdi was in charge of foreign relations for the Oromo Liberation Front, a southern independence movement which was also fighting Mengistu's regime.
People in Ethiopia generally were really neglected, ignored by the international community, and a lot of people felt there was a conspiracy, really, with this gang of military officers who were carrying out what amounted to really criminal programs against people in the north and the south. Here was the international community cooperating with them, giving them planes, vehicles, money, and everything to carry on with criminal activity.
Resources were pouring into Ethiopia. Over $1 billion worth in 84-85. Roughly 90% was channeled through the government side. And while the UN sought to restrict the diversion of aid to the government's armies, it couldn't stop the government from using the aid operation as a source of foreign currency and scarce equipment like lorries, and as a way of controlling population movements for military advantage.
There was a big lie. Essentially, it would have been very embarrassing, not only for the Ethiopians, but for the donor, if the truth had been revealed. If it had been revealed that when the Ethiopian army went out on a major offensive and established garrisons, the aid agencies followed them and started feeding the captive population. That the aid agencies were not, for the most part, ready to support the majority of the famine-stricken people who lived outside government control. If these truths had been told, it would have been really very, very difficult for all these players in the West.
I don't think anybody who was there could walk away from it and say, I'll take the political high ground and say, you know, we shouldn't be here because it's just keeping up the Mengistu government. I mean, I think that's an equally arbitrary sort of view of the situation. The responsibility that we had and that individuals felt very strongly was to see how far they could push back the boundaries, and eventually, from working with within, I think they pushed back the boundaries far further than non-engagement.
Agencies could have gotten together amongst themselves and made a division of labor, saying some people operate on the government side, some people can operate on the rebel side, let's discreetly coordinate what's happening here so we don't unwittingly become pawns in the game of this war that's being prosecuted. And I think there was an absolute reluctance to do anything of the sort.
It's Christmas time. There's no need to be afraid.
The world was visiting Ethiopia, but as the aid started to flow, it was caught up in a crossfire of motives and interests. Aid agencies working in harrowing conditions wanted to feed the starving they were seeing, not to get involved in Ethiopian politics. Meanwhile, back in Addis Ababa, the UN had sent a top official to coordinate the aid operation and deal with the Ethiopian dictator.
Michael Priestley heads the UN team here. He says the world must help more or accept a catastrophe.
I think aid has to come to Ethiopia. And without it, the country is extraordinarily poor. By the time I arrived, Mengistu had got used to the idea of the UN playing this central role between him and his government and the Western donors. So there were very few problems with Mengistu. He was obviously anxious to see that the famine relief operation went as well as possible.
There was a problem, though. For just as the aid operation was reaching its height, the Ethiopian government revived the old idea of resettlement, but in a new and more brutal form.
The rehabilitation program has already seen scores of thousands of people voluntarily airlifted from the drought-affected areas to the new pastures of the lowland plains.
This forced relocation program was visibly a terrible thing when you saw just the people being taken away for the resettlement. They had to send at dawn hundreds of militia people or workers, parties, people to surround the camp, and then at gunpoint or with sticks they were pushing the people to the trucks, separating the children from the mothers, the families, taking no care whatsoever about the state of the people, just meeting the quotas they had to make. They had to take, let's say, 1,000 people for this day, so they took 1,000 people.
For aid workers, the dilemma seemed protest and risk expulsion, or keep quiet and keep saving lives.
People who've worked in Ethiopia are aware of the political reality of Ethiopia. The issue is whether you still feel that as an agency there is something that you can do to save lives, and clearly, confronted with the death rates that we were in the early stages, the saving of life was paramount.
In fact, the problem was not this one at that time. We were accomplices of massive suffering, of massive oppression of the people. And in 1985, the main reason of suffering was forced relocation.
At the height of the aid operation, over 500,000 people were shipped hundreds of miles from the northern highlands to the south. The government claimed it was resettling them in more fertile areas. But there was the suspicion that it was trying to strip the rebel north of its population and that the relief camps were being used as bait to lure in people to be captured.
They decided that relief would be given only to those who would accept voluntarily to leave for those new relocation places. And then blackmail started. Deadly blackmail, because people who could not receive blankets, food, medicines, were people who were condemned to death.
When Barbara Hendry arrived in Tigray in February 1985, she witnessed tens of thousands of people walking for over a month to eastern Sudan, rather than a couple of hours into town to the international food aid camps.
When I asked people why, they all said basically the same things, is that if we go to the towns, we are going from a rebel area to a government area. We are going into the hands of our enemies, effectively. And what we fear is that we will be conscripted into the army, or we will be resettled in the south of Ethiopia. And individual people related instances of one family member going into the town and simply never coming back. So people made their own choices. They voted with their feet.
What they were avoiding was seen by a UN food monitor in Wollo province, John Mitchell, despite the strict curfew.
People would be taken on the trucks at night to the main transit camp in Desi, which is the capital of Wollo. And it just so happened that I could actually see this camp from my front porch, upon which I used to sit and drink my tea. It was just down a hill. These places were rather hellish places. You would have groups of people who would be waiting to be resettled. They would be waiting there until the trucks arrive, and because there was a shortage of trucks, they would be waiting a long time. And these places didn't have proper sanitation. They didn't have food. People were just living on the ground under polythene sheeting, this kind of thing. And so people would die, and their bodies would stay there, and the places would be alive with fleas. And they were hellish, hellish kind of places.
Mitchell was sending monthly reports back to the UN in Addis. The head there in mid-85 sought to play the issue down, saying that Mengistu didn't approve of the use of force and that resettlement was one solution to Ethiopia's problems.
Ethiopia could not feed itself. But the way it has been done was not, in my opinion, good. There were some incidents on the local level that involved coercion, but they were, I think, isolated, and they were not sanctioned by the government, but they did happen.
Only one organization made a systematic investigation of resettlement during the famine. Cultural Survival, an American-based group of anthropologists, interviewed nearly 300 resettlement victims who had fled to Sudan, publishing their findings in mid-85. Bonnie Holcomb was co-author of the report. An expert on southern Ethiopia, she speaks Oromo, the southern language.
After we had finished about a third of our interviews, we began to realize that the death rates were astronomical. People reported significant percentages of deaths in the holding centers. We'd ask them how many people were transferred onto the airplanes. People died in the airplane. They were lined up, 350 people in the hold of a cargo plane that was intended to accommodate 18 to 30 paratroopers fully equipped.